from Brno University of Technology, where he worked on recurrent neural networks-based language models. Then he worked in Google Brain, and since 2014, he's a research scientist in Facebook. His goal, research goal, is to train some general intelligence which would be able to learn and communicate with people. And today he prepared a talk about general AI, about what general AI is, what it is not, where is the hype, where is the reality. So, Tom, it's yours. Thank you.
Thank you for the introduction. It's great that so many people did come today. So I'll be talking about more like this high-level questions that we have when we are trying to solve like the open problems for like how to approach general artificial intelligence. So, I will start with some basic ideas. Even like to explain the term itself, I think that there's a lot of confusion nowadays because the community that is working on machine learning is growing very quickly. There's a lot of confusion about like what artificial intelligence even is, what would be the definition, and then there are terms like strong AI, general AI. So I think it's good to say like in some plain words what this could mean. So the general AI is supposed to be like this big goal that many researchers have for like maybe since the 50s in the last century, like how to build like the real artificial intelligence, like some machine that can learn more and more and become in theory even like more intelligent than humans. It's more like the type of AI that you can see in the science fiction movies. So some examples of what this general AI could be, should be able to do is like answer questions, control a robot, or play video games, do independent research on its own, and write computer programs. All of these, and it should not be scripted to perform just some list of tasks. It should really be able to be kind of like open-ended, to be able to learn to perform like new tasks efficiently and quite quickly. So maybe it's also good to say what are some simple examples, just to give intuition about the general AI is not. Well, very task-specific, single-purpose, manually coded algorithms are not really AI. Like a very dumb example can be like a pocket calculator. I think that most of the people would not consider a calculator AI, even if it's actually quite complicated on its own and it's providing useful mathematical results for human users. But it cannot learn anything new. It's basically hard-coded to do just one specific function, and it will never do in its lifetime anything else when the user is using it. A little bit more complicated example can be, for example, a bot that plays StarCraft against you, because suddenly it's much more complicated thing than the calculator. So some people can say, oh, well, if the bot will be playing as well as a human, then maybe it's an example of like general AI and something great that happened. Well, it's not really the case based on the definition, because if the bot really does just one thing, and especially if it's fixed in its lifetime, it's not doing anything adaptive at all, maybe just choosing different strategies that work the best against humans, while the strategies that are found or are even predefined, that's not really like a general AI. To give example, what it cannot do is that such a bot will, for example, never learn to chat with you in a game, because it's basically completely out of the scope of the machine. So I hope it's a bit more clear that this general AI that used to be called strong AI, what it's supposed to mean. Well, definitely currently nobody knows how to build such algorithms that would allow us to have this sort of intelligence in the computers, but more and more groups are working on this for different reasons. Definitely one of the big ones is that everybody knows that like a good solution will have amazingly huge value. You could just replace Google if you could build a machine that, for example, can talk at you and answer your queries in an intelligent way instead of just giving you some dumb list of documents. As current search engines do. the same time, I must also say that a lot of people in the recent years did join this AI research because there simply seems to be a lot of funding recently, and we are living in this time of the AI hype when many companies and managers leading these companies are convinced that AI is going to change their business very rapidly, and they don't even know what AI is. They just are hiring people, and then there are like these bidding wars over startups and so on. That is kind of going a little bit crazy, but that's another problem. If we would actually want to solve AI of this type, then I think that we can start at very simple problems first, like how to even define the end goal, and what is the metric of success, so that we see that we are getting closer. That's actually an open problem, because nobody actually knows how to do even this simple thing. It was like this famous Turing test that was proposed, I think, in the 50s in the last century, that has been criticized for many things, but basically the main idea is that if you can build a computer that can have intelligent conversation with a human user, then that's pretty much the thing that we would like to have. Actually, it's interesting that I think just today I did see two different messages that various famous people are proposing that AI research should be focusing more on language in the future. I think one of them was Bill Gates, and the other one was Paul Allen, actually. Both of them are from Microsoft. But definitely there seems to be a lot of language in the minds of people who think about the future of AI research. Well, once we would be able to set this goal and metric, then of course the obvious question: how do we actually develop this machine that will be intelligent and that will be addressing these questions? By describing one possible plan that we put together at Facebook. And of course, also many people here have experience with machine learning techniques, so you can be wondering which ones you should use, maybe what are the disadvantages of the current popular techniques, and that's what I will mention in this talk as well. I think it's really good to first not think about the techniques that we have at hand if we are trying to solve this goal, but think about the real important problems that we want to solve in the long term. So the best I could come up with here is really like mostly language examples, because I think that's language understanding is really great, great long term. Then in our plan, we did think that because such long term is like kind of impossible to even approach. Using our current understanding of the problem, then maybe you should try to limit the complexity and come up with some sort of like sub-problems that would be still crucial parts of the full problem. And finally, develop techniques that can actually solve the more complicated tasks than is currently doable with the current state of the art of machine learning. The plan is described in a detail in the paper that we call the roadmap towards machine intelligence. We think that there could be many roadmaps, and we actually recommend other research groups to write their roadmaps. So we are hoping that they will also like put together some more ambitious goal than just writing papers about building a bigger classifier on ImageNet. So let's hope that in the future there will be more of these crazy plans. And back to ours. In our plan, we did try to limit the complexity as much as possible, maybe even more than is good. We did try to identify the abilities or things that basically have to be present in any useful general AI plan. The first thing is the ability to perform tasks for human users, because if you remove this point, that you can end up with some general AI that will be living on its own for its own purposes, but it will be very disconnected from us. It can be, for example, the projects on artificial life, which I think are super exciting and interesting on their own, but that's not exactly what we want to focus on, because having AI that's disconnected from the goals of human users can be, in theory, dangerous in the long term, and in practice can be even difficult to evaluate and observe what such systems are doing, because they can be doing completely different things than we do as humans. Then the ability to efficiently learn and improve, I think, should be really part of any system that aspires to be general AI. It's kind of funny that sometimes people develop a system that is completely frozen when it comes to its parameters in when it's used to deploy it in the test time. And still these people would call the system an example of general AI. I think that's completely misleading. If the system cannot learn while it is interacting with the users, and it will be doing the same mistakes again and again, and it will be not even able to, for example, memorize new skills and new facts. So that seems it seems basically impossible to remove this component, even if some proposals do. Well, then there's ability to communicate. I think that's something that's not maybe completely obvious, but it's actually very related to the other points. If you want to be able to efficiently learn from basically interacting with the human users, then basically you have to be able to communicate somehow, and the language seems to be or is the most efficient communication that we as humans are using. And even if you want to perform tasks for the human users, then again you need to be able to even understand what are the tasks that the humans are specifying, and for that you will need the communication. And then there are other things that actually, some people would love to see in the proposal to be there from the beginning. We decided to not really focus on these at STAR, but maybe they will be necessary to get the AI working reasonably fast when it comes to the training. this is still unknown. I have here some list of ideas which I think are very interesting. We can, for example, let the AI live in virtual worlds, which we are also considering in our proposal. We can add multimodal perception, like maybe just the language is not sufficient. Maybe we need to add vision and audio signals as additional inputs to the machine during its development. Maybe we even need to have multiple AIs to communicate between themselves. Well, I think all these ideas are actually very interesting, but actually not clearly necessary. We don't know if they are basically necessary or not. For example, some argument can be that vision is not a requirement for intelligence. There are people who are blind that are completely intelligent, and maybe just ability to add new sensor inputs is required, and the inputs don't have to be present from the beginning. If we want to focus on developing new algorithms that we are convinced that we need for building the AI, then maybe limiting the complexity is a good thing. And here is a concrete example. Here I will also describe why we think that we actually, or why we are convinced that we need different approaches and new approaches in machine learning. This is how we think that a working general AI that's built around communication could help you or anyone in your life. It's a little bit complicated example, but basically it goes such a way that I create some task that the machine should remind me whenever it's raining that I should bring umbrella in case that I would forget to do it myself. And the machine doesn't need to have this knowledge already. But it should be able to acquire it efficiently. That means here it's actually asking how it should do it, and the human can just say it through the words, and then the machine will just trigger whenever the condition happens to be true and just reminds the user to bring the umbrella. So there's actually the interesting thing. If you think that instead of the machine there will be some person, then it's quite logical that this conversation is completely realistic. This can simply happen. People can learn to perform tasks in place of the machine. There's nothing magical about it. But from the machine learning point of view, what the machine has to do here is basically unsupervised learning, because where do you see the supervision here? There's no supervision in the form that, for example, neural networks expect anywhere. Maybe the user is saying some vague instructions or hints what the machine should be trying to do, but there's nothing like what you see in the neural network world where you have the input vectors and output vectors and target vectors. There's no target vector here. And we think it's completely unrealistic to believe that there ever will be this information provided by human users. It's basically not part of our efficient communication. So this is also an example of what we mean by unsupervised learning. Basically, based on the inputs that the machine observes, it should be changing its own structure so that it can become more efficient. So here I have a list of these problems or topics that people can be thinking of if they want to make some breakthrough in the machine learning community. Definitely more and more people in the last year started to talk about unsupervised learning as being the big next goal. I think one of them is, for example, Janneke, I think Jevinton and the others talk more and more about unsupervised learning. Of course, this is also related to reward-based learning. I can say reinforcement learning. Also there, often people are using a little bit too many of the rewards. I think it's better to really just take the unsupervised learning and not think really that one can learn from the rewards, but really one has to be able to learn from the inputs. And then there's the compositional and incremental learning that I will talk about more in detail later, but that's actually a very obvious observation that you can make when it comes to language learning, that we can be building our knowledge in some additive way. Some people call it like gradual way, that you can learn a new topic and new skill, you can gain new knowledge and base it on what you learned before. That sounds very obvious for people, but we did actually put together some environment that can test for this, and together with Goody, a startup from Prague, we did help them basically to set a competition last year. I will later talk about the results, but so far basically nobody could develop techniques that can learn in this incremental way, even in very toyish cases. Then the other thing that's actually surprisingly missing still in the machine learning models that we have these days is some good version of long-term memory. Again, I will talk later in more detail about this means, but it's good to notice that typical deep learning and neural networks, deep learning techniques and neural networks have very limited types of memory. Recurrent networks have just short-term memory, and feed-forward networks and recurrent networks have a memory in the weight matrices that is of a type like moving average. Once you keep showing these models examples that are completely different than what they were learned on before, they will just overwrite the old information and forget. This is well known since the 80s, but nobody did actually develop yet algorithms that can basically memorize new things without forgetting the old ones. Again, I think it's a great topic for people who want to do some new research, because it can be a big breakthrough if anybody can address any of these things. What we did focus on at first, which is, I think, well, it looks like the simplest one, but it's also pretty complicated, is to design new data sets and even training frameworks so that we can build the AI algorithms. If you pick a wrong task, then you basically have no chance to make progress. If you would want to build, for example, some great predictive models, and you would pick a task like rolling a dice, then you basically can't do better than frequency. So you can do whatever you want. Complicated research and it will lead to nowhere. The same way, if you pick a task to do, for example, sentiment analysis on some very simple short sentences, where simple techniques will already give you 99% accuracy, then you can do whatever you like. But again, there's no room for progress. And interestingly, actually, a large part of the machine learning community is optimizing tasks that either have been already solved, like MNIST, for example, works with almost 100% accuracy, and still people are publishing papers about this dataset, which is completely toyish. or people are working on tasks that are not do not seem to be related to AI and are definitely valuable tasks on their own, like machine learning tasks like image classification, but it's completely unclear their progress in image classification by creating large label data sets is bringing us closer to AI. Actually, most of the people would not agree with that. Still, it's what you usually see in the conferences, this type of research. So for the data set, we started with this environment that is used for like this research on communication-based artificial intelligence. It's open sourced, and we did publish it with several sets of very simple communication tasks where there is no strong supervision. Tasks are actually solvable by humans even without the prior knowledge of the communication protocols that are used. But because of their incremental complexities, I was saying the machine learning techniques as we have them now are actually not doing much on these. Here is the link to this environment. Here is an example of how a task can look like. For example, there is this teacher, which is basically a scripted version of what the later human user should be. The teacher is trying to teach through some basic communication channel, the learner, which stands for World Intelligent Machine, some very, very simple things where, well, the simplest thing that you can imagine could be, for example, some basic string manipulation functions. Just repeating a string of symbols seems to be quite complicated if you want to do it in this unsupervised way. That's actually doable. You can use, for example, reinforcement learning with recurrent networks. It's gonna be doable. It will not really generalize well to novel sequences of symbols. So, but then you can use some more fancy versions of recurrent networks, like one that I will be talking about later. And it's actually possible to learn this task. It will take definitely long. The machine will have to see like tens of thousands of examples. But eventually it will get it. You can learn it at SGD if you want to, but you have basically the rewards, so you don't even need to use SGD. You can use, for example, evolutionary search techniques, and eventually, if you have some reasonably good model, this is doable, although it's not easy at all. And then there's a more complicated task. Actually, this is an example of how the machine should actually receive a reward. So actually, this is when it does the right thing. And here is a more complicated task where the machine is supposed to do something very related to the previous task. Instead of repeating the word, as you can think of it, once, it is asked to repeat the word ABA twice. Of course, if you don't know what the word twice means, then you will probably try a few variants before you will find the solution as a human user. You can also say humans have a lot of prior knowledge, so they can get the solution quickly. But the fun thing is that if you will teach the machine learning algorithms, like say recurrent networks, to do this task after learning the first task, which was very related, there will be no obvious gain in the learning speed. Basically, whether you teach the machine from scratch to perform this task, or whether it's pre-trained on the previous task, there is no gain. There doesn't seem to be any ability of the machines to learn incrementally using, again, the existing algorithms. They don't seem to be able to do this. And of course, and what's the biggest problem here to say, learning the more complicated tasks seems to be taking much longer. And as you are increasing complexity of the tasks, you can end up with exponentially increasing complexity and required number of training examples that have to be seen before the machine does get what it's supposed to be doing. So this basically seems that we can't really build AI using, or general AI using the current algorithms, because whatever is more complicated than super trivial, the machine cannot learn it even if it already knows a lot of related related solutions to related tasks. I didn't describe basically this simple communication-based environment. There's nothing really special about it. Basically, just the machine and the simulated human, the teacher talks to each other through a communication channel, and the teacher can be assigning rewards whenever the machine does something right, and that's basically it. So it's very general. Actually, we helped the Good AI company last year to organize a challenge to see basically whether some enthusiasts who are trying to do AI research, for example, as PhD students at universities or even like people working in companies, whether they can actually come with some new ideas and develop techniques that will be able to learn incrementally. Of course, if somebody could do it, that would be like a huge breakthrough. So I think nobody did really expect a working solution, but the good thing is that the challenge does exist and people can still access the data and try. If you can actually find the solution, then you can be really rich, but you also should expect that it's going to be really super difficult to do something of this sort. So the competition happened last year. I think it lasted for like 6 months. And the goal was to test whether some techniques or some approaches that the competitors will try, whether these can learn in this incremental way. There was actually quite a lot of people who did register and who did try to do something. There was like 500 participants that registered. Only some did actually submit a solution in the end, some working solution. Actually, there was more of the submissions, but some were just theoretical proposals without some implementation, and some of them were not working. So just 7 of them are doing something. And out of the 46 evaluation tasks that I must say were very similar to the public tasks, but slightly different, only some could actually only like 7 evaluation tasks were solved at best out of 46. So that's not really that much. But it's even more important to say that out of the submitted solutions, none did actually exhibit any signs of incremental learning. So actually, because the submissions were basically some like open source codes, people from Good AI could try various experiments, including testing how fast would these submitted techniques learn if they would be, for example, learning every task from scratch. And there was actually no significant change in the learning speed when it comes to the number of observed examples that the techniques had to see before they started doing well. So there was basically no obvious transfer between related tasks, no transfer of the knowledge. Actually, the other experiment that we did talk about quite a bit was to see whether a human would be able to solve these tasks. And actually, all 46 tasks could have been solved by a human who was playing basically the role of the intelligent machine in like some 13 hours, which is quite remarkable because the tasks themselves in the Good AI competition have not very much to do with language. The human basically in the beginning has to guess what he should be doing. So the tasks are definitely solvable, and we don't really know how to do it. That's basically the conclusion. The approaches that people tried, sometimes quite unsuccessfully to the point that they would not even submit a solution, were like the usual ones that you can guess, the ones that are currently maybe too popular in the community, which is like some versions of recurrent networks trained with reinforcement learning, like DeepMind style, like what is being used for other games, that actually didn't really go very far. It was kind of funny to see that much simpler techniques based on evolution research were actually working slightly better, and they're actually much simpler to implement. I think there was quite a few results of this type in the last 1 or 2 years, where, for example, other groups than DeepMind were showing that they can even like play Atari games with evolutionary algorithms, just straight from pixels and everything the same as DeepMind, but much better and much faster and easier. So I think that this deep learning plus reinforcement learning is completely overrated these days, and it's good if people would think outside of the box and not just repeat whatever is considered as the best thing at the moment, because we really don't have the best thing for AI. So again, for the open problems, I did only talk quite a bit about unsupervised learning, so just again to say, like, in other words, people are aiming for what you may know as this learning to learn ability, where basically from some weak supervision, the hope is that the machine will be able to develop some mechanisms how to update itself, so that in the future, just based on the inputs, it will be able to modify its parameters. That's not exactly happening, for example, in feed-forward networks, the whole structure is completely fixed, and if there are no target vectors, there is no gradients to compute, and there will be no change in the weight matrices, and there will be no learning happening. So typical feed-forward networks have no ability to learn to learn, or actually even recurrent networks can be just addressing the past inputs through like the accumulated signals in the hidden layers, like through learning to learn, there the models would be able to develop some mechanisms how to change themselves. It's basically not part of the models as we have them now. Later I will show some model that can actually do this in very, very many way, but definitely very limited. For example, if we would be able to learn how to learn, then the learner should be able to store new facts and memorize new things. But this is really like not really working yet. The compositional incremental learning I did also like to talk about quite a bit. So how can we build some learners or models that would be able to learn new skills without learning basically from scratch all the time? There's definitely some success when it comes to transfer learning in very, very simple tasks, like you can learn a classifier of say images, or even like you can pre-train some word representations and use these features later in different tasks. So definitely some sort of transfer learning works in machine learning, like that's definitely true, but transfer learning more on the algorithmic level, on the level that is required, for example, to learn language examples that I was showing before, like from learning to repeat the word once to learning to repeat the word twice, that sort of transfer learning doesn't work. Just basically some basic feature sharing in classifiers, that's what currently does work. And the long-term memory, again, like there's a lot of questions that people have now. There's not really much any great proposals so far, even for such a basic thing. I would also say like that I think that actually in the end, all these problems that I'm talking about are actually quite related, because you probably cannot solve this compositional learning or incremental learning unless you already have some long-term memory in the model. Because if your model just has short-term memory or weighted average type of memory as neural networks have, then basically there's no hope for developing incremental learning, because how can the technique base new solutions on the previous ones if the previous ones are already forgotten or overwritten? So here is some example of a model that we proposed 3 years ago for like at least inspiring people how to think about some new things, new methods. And this one actually has some ability to learn what normal recurrent networks don't learn. I will not describe the model in detail, but basically it's a special version of recurrent network when there's some topology on the recurrent layer, which in this case can be seen as some special version of continuous stack. So people who have computer science background probably know what stack is. It's basically like this inflatable structure where you can be putting on top of it new information. And the ability to inflate to basically any size is actually completely crucial to stack and also to this model to have its unique ability. So we could actually show that it can learn a bunch of algorithms in quite unsupervised way, basically by observing examples only, by figuring out how to basically use various stacks, because it actually had multiple stacks, not just one, how to perform the actions like push and pop and so on, so that it would figure out the solution. We also showed that it can be learned both by SGD. We have some special version, special formulation of the stack that is basically continuous, so that we can actually the whole memory can be seen as differentiable, which is something that some people were stressing out as very important property. Well, we didn't completely see it as necessary, because at the end of our paper, we did also show already in 2015 that we can be using search to basically learn comparably good solutions to some of the problems where search actually does not require the memory to be differentiable and is much simpler to be implemented. So just to say here, what is interesting about this model, it has some sort of like long-term memory in the sense that the model is basically modifying just the topmost elements on top of the stacks, and the old information can basically stay exactly the same for a very long time without being changed. Only basically subset of the stack is changed, just the topmost things. And then the middle point, I think, is the completely crucial one, because you can see that even say recurrent networks under some conditions can store information for a very long time, and they can also change only a subset of the memory. But what normal recurrent networks do not have, including LSTMs and all kinds of variants with different architectures, is the ability to increase in capacity. Normal recurrent networks basically are stored at a fixed number of bits, and they have no way how to basically increase in size. So the amount of information they can store is fixed. And in practice, they also, even if in theory some architectures can be modifying just parts of themselves, in practice they just tend to mix everything together. So these are like some properties that I think good long-term memory should have. Of course, there are many drawbacks why the stacks are not the best type of long-term memory, which are exactly the same reasons why modern computers are not using stacks as a memory, but the random access memory, because it will basically take forever to cycle through the stack when you are trying to access some other information. So this is more like a direction to think about when people want to develop some new models. So another thing that we didn't publish, but didn't publish yet, we'll probably in the future, but that's basically just for like illustration and for you to think about center architecture, where you can think of say recurrent network that would be able to add neurons to the hidden layer. So again, it would be able to increase in a capacity. Then there are some problems that basically the number of connections in the weight matrix, in the recurrent weight matrix, would be basically increasing in square, which is basically too fast. So there are like some practical versions that we have of this idea. But the main point is really that how can we develop models that would be keeping the old information intact, do not really change it, be able to access it, and still learn new things. So it really seems that we need to develop some growing mechanisms, and that's what actually some of us are working on now. So for the conclusion, I would say that if people are talking about general AI, I think it's good to know what it actually means, and some people are actually kind of twisting the original sense quite a bit. Actually, the term itself was developed like 10 or 15 years ago by some people who are getting upset with the AI term being used for all kinds of things that have nothing to do actually with the original AI goals, including some basic pattern recognition systems and so on. But there are also like older names that are a little bit forgotten now, like strong AI and so on. So I think this is something good to keep in mind, that not everything that is currently sold in the media as examples of general AI, that not everything actually is general AI, especially when you see something, some example of a single purpose machine that can perform just one very, very narrow task and nothing else. And that's not general AI. Maybe the algorithms that this machine is using will be interesting in the future for the research of general AI, but these examples of like these chess playing machines and Go playing machines, that's not general AI at all. That's the exact opposite. That's the narrow AI. And for like the last points, there's definitely a lot of hype in the last years, and as I said, like there are a lot of reasons for it, because the industry is expecting some magical results, and some people are promising them, especially the ones that are trying to sell their startups, and for them it has been working quite well recently. But there's definitely a subset of machine learning that joins the money, and there are people who are trying to work on new things, and then there are people who are promising everything. So there are like different groups with different motivations. Just a few things that I did mention here is that many of the ideas actually are reoccurring and are reintroduced under new names by authors who actually know the old papers but are either not citing them or mentioning somewhere like just one small reference. It's happening very intentionally. Quite complicated models are also introduced for tasks where they basically have no sense, and people don't try the simpler ones or older techniques, or if they do, the comparison is actually flawed. There's all the time like baselines missing. Then there's comparison, then people compare techniques trained on different data sets. It's completely misleading. I think the reason of these mistakes are two. For the more senior researchers, it's definitely PR. Many people are just learning from basically getting into the news, and that's what they are getting paid for. And the other thing is that the community did grow like maybe 10 or 20 times, just looking at the number of participants at NIPS, that's completely crazy. Like last year the conference was sold out, I think in like 2 days or 2 hours, I forget. It was super quickly sold out, a bit like 8,000 participants. It's completely out of the hand, and as you can imagine, if a community grows this quickly, then most of the people actually have very little experience, and these people are actually writing the papers nowadays, and then, as you can imagine, there's a lot of reinvention of the wheel and mistakes and so on. So I think it's good also like sometimes to read some older papers, even like from 80s, 90s. There was a lot of good ideas back then. And also think critically about the current state of the art. If you want to do some great research on your own, I think it's definitely good to think on your own instead of like just downloading some example from TensorFlow or whatever and running it and tweaking the hyperparameters. You are probably not gonna make some revolution by doing that, because there are like tens of thousands of other people who are doing exactly the same thing. So I would definitely encourage people to think about new problems and their own ideas, how to approach them, and not just blindly believe in what some famous people are saying today. So that's all. Thanks for the attention, and I will answer all the questions.
Okay, so we will cover the questions from Slido, but maybe is there somebody in the audience who would like to put first question? If no, so let's go for the first one from Slido. You said many researchers groups are working on the development of such general AI. Who do you think is now far? Who is the lead on the race, in your opinion?
Well, the groups that did state this quite officially are for sure at least DeepMind, OpenAI, Facebook AI Research, and I'm not sure if Google Brain does any projects of this sort, but I'm pretty sure they are interested as well. And then there are other companies like Baidu. I know that they are also quite interested in this sort of thing. They had on basically like the very similar type of tasks as what I was showing. Who else is there? That's the ones that I can think of. Well, definitely IBM is also interested in similar things, although their IBM Watson is based on, I would say, like, not the kind of technology that I would consider reasonable for this type of research. It's more like a collection of many almost. And then, of course, there are universities, and there's quite a lot of them. Also, Uber, I think, is a group that is focusing on this, I think they call it open-ended AI. Can I think of more? Oh, yeah, sure, then there are universities. It's, yeah, with Jürgen Spinnuber, I think he's interested in the same thing for like 20, 30 years. That's what comes to my mind now. Who is now further in progress? It's actually very difficult to say because, as I was talking about, problems that are quite easy to identify, like, say, long-term memory, well, nobody did come with anything even close to the solution so far. So when it comes to PR, I would say that definitely DeepMind is leading PR and visibility. Besides this, I would say that the groups are comparable. Basically, we are thinking about similar problems. And when it comes to some breakthrough technology, it didn't happen yet. I think people are not even expecting it to happen every year. And just like you can look at neural networks themselves, they are so popular now. And it took like many, many years to develop this technology to a state that they are actually working well. I don't know.
Okay, so let's continue with the most loaded questions. As a professional, when do you see this happening? Brain-like neural networks, strong AI, AI reaching thousands of IQ points, nanotechnology, nanomedicine, immortality.
I'm not sure if it's possible to reach thousands of IQ points from the definition, but a lot of points, let's assume. Nanotechnology and nanomedicine, I think, are also a little bit different things. I think actually AI could help us to build such technologies, which could be super interesting. When I see these things happening, that's actually completely like a wild guess, and nobody really knows. If I would be optimistic, then I would say that I hope that I will live long enough to actually see some progress, it's really hard to say. I'm kind of skeptical in the sense that, in my opinion, not really much new things happened in the last 10 years, except that the community is now much bigger, and people are also interested in these questions, so I think that the new generation of researchers actually has very good potential. If they will not keep optimizing some dropout rates on MNIST models, but if they will actually think about solving some new fundamental things, new problems, like long-term memory or maybe even completely different ones, but basically doing something new, then maybe we'll see actually things happening much sooner than later. So let's be optimistic about this. But I will not really tell you any number.
Does your team comprehend how your neural networks work? Do you understand how it got the results it gave? Can you debug it?
Well, I would say definitely this is another like a PR myth, in my opinion, when people are saying, oh, neural networks that we developed are so great, we can't even understand them anymore. They are getting these amazing results and nobody knows why. It's amazing, it's AI. You know, so I think that everybody did hear these stories. That's PR, nothing else. So in my case, when it comes to, say, these recurrent networks, I know what they are doing exactly well. When it comes to, these word vectors, yes, there's nothing mysterious about it. Everything can be explained quite easily. The success of, say, recurrent networks, basically like clustering of sequences, it sounds mysterious if you would basically spend a few hours thinking of it and maybe some time experimenting with the models, running experiments. Basically, sooner or later, you just get it and you know what is possible, what is impossible, what problems you can solve, what not. There's something magical. I think you can just scratch the board words, neural networks, and just replace them by some sequences of nonlinear projections, which are close to linear. And that's basically what neural networks are. There's basically nothing magical. It's a bunch of weight matrices with some simple nonlinearity. Neural networks have nothing to do with the brain. Basically, just a fancy name that was chosen for PR reasons, and that's it.
You mentioned that some data sets are simply unsuitable for AI analysis. Do you have some test or rule of thumb to assess which data sets are suitable?
No, it's actually very difficult. As I was mentioning, the need for new data sets in the open problems, I think this is more like a topic that more people should be thinking about. We did make our proposal to be more concrete. That's the CommAI environment. We believe that it's reasonably good, but we would be definitely very happy if more groups would be doing work of this type. It's maybe easier to say which data sets are not suitable, which in my opinion are pretty much all those that are focusing just on supervised learning, which is actually most of the existing ones, because it's unrealistic to expect that you will get basically, you will be able to have this much supervision for any machine that basically doesn't seem to be possible.
Aren't you afraid of AI getting out of control?
Not really. I think it's really, it reminds me these stories about, for example, when in the 18th century or so, when people did see, for example, trains for the first time, and they did think that it's some crazy machine from the hell and so on, and they were afraid of it. I mean, whenever people see some new technology that they don't understand, they are just thinking about how is it going to be dangerous to them. People are afraid of new things. But really, once you start understanding what you are doing, then I think that AI, and even the AI that we can develop in the future, is just going to be a tool for us humans to achieve things. And like the AI that I was talking about is basically some machine that is helping humans to accomplish their goals. The motivation is actually coming from the humans. So even if the AI would actually have more IQ points than the human user, basically, there's no motivation in the AI. If all the motivation of AI is just to basically just do good things for the user that user requests, then I'm basically not afraid that it would get any more out of control than, for example, a car gets out of control. The car also can move faster than humans, and it can be dangerous if you don't drive it well. But the car, if nobody's using it, basically it's not driving anywhere. And I think that AI without motivation, with just a single purpose, which is to accomplish tasks for the users. Basically, there's nothing dangerous in it, unless the users themselves are dangerous.
Okay, there are some questions about jQuery and your presentation style, so you can maybe ask during the beer session after, and let's go to some others. So I remember about some model type which seems more promising for making a general AI than neural networks.
Well, I was mentioning in the slides a few times that there are like techniques that or communities that did try to work with something else than neural networks, like these evolutionary techniques that don't need gradients, and actually on the tasks where people are evaluating some of the fancier reinforcement learning techniques these days. These techniques are really competitive. I think that's interesting direction to think about. I would definitely warn people from buying everything that this community did produce, because many of the promises are also like not very fulfilled, and just plain evolutionary techniques, in my opinion, are deeply flawed, and they are like really crucial mistakes. But I think that there's definitely some interesting part of it. Basically, if you look at it, the main thing is being able to search over some interesting space of candidate solutions. And if you look actually at how people did think about AI in the 60s or 70s, like for example, at some old papers from Minsky, who I think did write actually some sort of like something similar to the roadmap to AI paper in the 60s. For him, basically, SGD was just a subset of CERT, so he didn't even like consider it as something special. And he was writing basically in an AI paper a lot about CERT. So I think that's something that people should consider. A CERT and a good CERT space is something that if one can define well, then I think that there can be interesting results in the future.
Aren't you afraid that you will create the opposite of the good AI, something like happened to Microsoft Netsy chatbot?
Well, I think that Microsoft did get a bit too excited about publishing basically what you can see as like a language model that learns from the user interactions or learns basically just repeats to the users what users tell to the chatbot, which I think was abused by very quickly by some community who did produce automatically a lot of requests for this chatbot and they did lead the conversation in such a way that once the chatbot started repeating these things after these automated users, then it started repeating the things that the people who did make these requests want to see, and it was basically just a joke to show that we all love Microsoft, right? I think there was nothing advanced about this. If you know what technology it used, then it's basically nothing about Nezi, how was it pronounced in English, chatbot, but it was just basically repeating these stupid jokes that some people that basically hack into it.
How far away from a master algorithm do you think teams like DeepMind are? Based on your perception of AI progress, do you think we will see a super AI before 2050?
Well, that's simple. I think I already answered it. I think that DeepMind and everybody else is pretty much the same far from developing the solution because nobody basically has anything extra yet. If anybody would actually have something working, then I think we would see huge PR articles all over the place. And the second question, then, of course, do you think else? Well, 2015. Well, I hope so. This is the best I can say. It's kind of impossible to say. Like, if you would be asking people, say, 200 years ago, when we will build the first airplane. Well, that's hard to say. There will be like some strong focus by the amazing people would be focusing on the problem. Maybe the airplanes could have happened 15 years sooner, maybe 15 years later. So like guessing 100 years ago when we will fly to the moon. I think it's quite surprising that there was such huge progress that people could fly to the moon so quickly after building the first reasonable airplanes. Maybe the same will happen with AI, that once we will crack some small things, that the further progress will be much faster. I, for example, believe that if we can make the incremental working, incremental learning working, that will be actually the like acceleration of the research, because then finally we will have techniques that can learn more and more and not forget and basically get basically better and better. So that's my hope. We shall see about it.
Next question, what project are you, your team, currently working on? How big is your team? What's the biggest day-to-day challenge?
My team, like Welfare, is basically a whole number of individual researchers. So we don't really have exactly teams. It's more like that people are working together, but it's kind of disorganized, I would say, often. What projects I'm currently working on? I'm mostly like interested in like contributing to like either some applied projects that are trying to do things in the right way, like say fast text recently, or when it comes to communication AI, I'm trying to make things going in the right direction, which I think is not trivial at all. People often like to jump on like kind of the solutions that are not going to work but that are easiest to do, like trying some new type of LSTM again and again on these type of problems, which also happens sometimes, and I'm trying to make sure that people also spend some time by trying to do some new stuff. It's pretty difficult. Well, what is the biggest day-to-day challenge? Well, this is maybe not day-to-day, but I think the biggest challenge for me is how to convince people to try to do new things instead of doing the easy things. You can definitely be a successful researcher these days, like a moderately successful researcher these days, by just reading papers, doing a bunch of reviews for conferences, visiting conferences, giving some talks here and there, and basically do the same things that you are doing always, but again, the same stuff. And basically a cycle of these small improvements over tasks that are already kind of solved, say, image classification, you will just take your best model and you will tweak it to be like 0.5% better on ImageNet, and you have a new paper because you will say that it's a great thing. I think this is the biggest challenge that is in front of me and other people, to basically break this cycle, and how can we all start spending more time on doing things that actually have potential to make big changes instead of wasting time on things that give us this feeling of safety, because even researchers at Facebook sometimes need to feel some validation of their work, and if you can keep publishing one or two papers per year by just reinventing what you already did, that's definitely much safer than spending 5 years by working on something that will not result even in a single paper, because you will just realize that you did make some mistake in the design in the beginning, or you simply couldn't find a solution. So I think these are like the big challenges, not just for me, but for people in the other teams working on AI research.
Do you think solving incremental learning is enough necessary, or is transfer learning necessary?
Well, I think that transfer learning is sort of like became a name for like more like this transfer of features, which is definitely doable between tasks. It works, but it's nothing magical. So I prefer to call it incremental learning, but this is the terminology. It's hard to see whether it's enough or necessary. I think it would be a huge step forward, and it's hard to predict how far can it go. I would say nobody knows these days if we can release soft techniques that can learn this way, that they can really like add more and more knowledge without losing the old one, and learn faster. In my opinion, it could be actually enough to solve AI, but nobody has anything of this sort, so I don't know. I hope that it will be actually a big step forward.
What's the difference between doing research at Google versus Facebook?
Well, both these companies are changing all the time, including how research is done. There, like to just give example about Google, when it started Google Research, it was completely applied. People just spent their time in the beginning by reading papers written by researchers and implementing them in Google products. So it was totally applied, but as the company was growing larger, it basically to see that it needs to become the leader in research to also like, because there was a lot of smart people in the first place who actually wanted to do some new exciting things instead of just doing the boring re-implementations of what other people did. Also, Google, I think, wanted from some time to start leading the research directions. And then Facebook, as a younger company, was kind of repeating what Google did, just some way faster. So it actually started quite quickly, this AI research team with pretty ambitious goals, but pretty much just a bit later, even Google basically did reorganize the research from what I've heard, and their current goals are, say, much more ambitious than they used to be like 5 years ago. For example, when it comes to Google Brain, they started mostly as an applied team, and when I was there myself, really our main task, how we were evaluated, was not so much to do some impactful research for the outside, but more like impact the products in the inside. But the team was led pretty well in my opinion, so actually I was completely doing fine when I was more focused on the external things, like these things with the word vectors and so on that I published when I was there. Later, when I left, the reorganized in such a way that actually people started getting credit for publishing the work, and now it's completely comparable to what roles that Facebook set for its AI research group in the beginning, which is to basically do impactful research that is visible on the outside and that is hopefully something new and related to AI.
Okay, let's do last three questions and we'll let the rest questions for the networking guys. So, did someone from Facebook research participate in Good AI Challenge? Is the challenge interesting for your research?
I think it's definitely interesting, and we did participate as advisors on this challenge, so we didn't really try to win the competition. I think that would be kind of unfair. I don't know if we would be able to succeed or not. We didn't try. I think it would be pretty strange if the advisors of the challenge were to actually win it. The good thing is that people can still continue using the challenge even now. So if people actually develop some algorithms, they can test them. From my point of view, we first need to have techniques that can actually exhibit the properties that I was talking about, like long-term memory and so on. So in my opinion, we should first focus on developing models in whatever settings we can, and the Good AI Challenge, in my personal opinion, will take quite a few years before people can start seeing some progress, which I think is definitely good, because it can be basically like guiding at least some small subset of the AI research community about what the goals for us could be for the future.
Next question was future of genetic biological inspired algorithm in development of AI. Is it interesting method for solving these problems?
Well, it could be, but it really depends on how far people take it. I think as inspiration, anything can be actually very good. And I think actually how biology works and how natural intelligence that emerge in nature, like there's tons of interesting things to consider. How do you even define natural intelligence? I didn't try to do it in the slides, but I think this could be a long talk on its own, and you can see that there are some processes that can be called intelligent, not just on the level of the individuals, but even on the level of societies of individuals, and even on the smaller levels, higher levels. There is basically this adaptive behavior that leads to some increasing complexity that's basically evolution itself. It seems to be kind of intelligent mechanism on its own. So I think there's a lot of things that could be discussed and that could motivate people to develop some new algorithms. I think it's a bit too far once people go to, for example, neuroscience, and then they start studying different parts of the brain and are trying to find some neuron that is doing this and that. I think that's really taking it too far. But just the genetic and biologic inspiration, I think that's definitely quite influential. People, for example, started thinking about artificial neural networks, I think in the 50s, in the last century, and definitely the brain was like a big inspiration, like the crude idea how the brain could be working was a crude inspiration. So I think it's definitely like a good source of ideas.
Okay, and the last question, can neural networks use knowledge graphs or databases as a long-term memory?
Possibly. I think that's actually the big hope for the significantly large community of people who are working on these knowledge graphs. Actually, when I was talking with them, it seemed to me that their long-term goal really is that if they can develop some huge database of facts, then later it will work as some sort of like long-term memory for the artificial intelligence, so that if you can develop this AI with common sense, as people call it, that would have some basic learning abilities and understanding, it can be querying the knowledge graph to basically access the information. So some people definitely think it is possible and meaningful. I am myself skeptical, I must say, because I think that you can just say that once you have a machine that understands the very basic vocabulary of the most frequent 100 English words, then you can just give access to this model to say Wikipedia, and it can basically just read the articles and extract the information as is needed, and it does not need to be structured in some rigid database like Knowledge Graph, which has quite a few problems on its own because it's actually missing a lot of information. It doesn't even seem possible to put together a complete knowledge graph with all possible facts. So basically the short question is, some people, quite a few of them, do consider this as a possibility. I am myself convinced that the long-term memory should be more like a part of the system and not so much external, and if one thinks of knowledge graph as external long-term memory, then I think it could be even better to think of Wikipedia as a long-term memory or basically information source for the AI.
Okay, and the rest of questions I would leave it for the networking guys. So thank you, Tomas, for your talk and for your answers. It was great. Thank you.